thing that you get, you know, I mean, you never sort of planned it to be, it just happened, it's just one of the things that sort of evolved and happened, and we didn't plan it to, didn't expect it to be as popular as it did, as it got, like.
I'm really enthused about it, just gone in and had fun, and like being almost scared to go in to mm-hmm. see what it was going to mm-hmm. come out like, because none of us knew what it was going to sound like.
I'm just a guitar player that wants to play, and people would say, well, it's unique to me. It would probably be the sound and maybe just the way I approach it, but how it is, I don't know. To explain yourself is quite difficult.
Come on in.
The way I got involved in music was just purely accidental. I'd bought a PA system, a 50-watt Vox PA. My father had got one on the drip for me. It was a 50-watt PA and a Shure mic. And I thought, well, I'll put an advert in the music shops, the instrument shops. And a geezer came round to the house, and he was in a band called The Rare Breed.
What?
You were playing with Ozzy?
Yeah, Ozzy and myself used to have a band, and me, Seth's guitarist, drummer, and I used to play rhythm guitar, and Ozzy was on vocals.
What was that band called?
The Rare Breed.
Rare Breed?
Yeah.
So I joined his band, but I didn't really like this guitar player. I thought he was an asshole, you know, so it wasn't really, I mean, in those days, when you play blues, you kind of like got to stand there, like cool with dark sunshade on and be cool, you know? I would jump around and get people going, and the guitar player would say, hey man, you're in a blues band, man, you know, blues guy. I said, yeah, screw you, you know? So I said to Geezer one night, I said, you know what, man? I said, if I go on the stage with that guy again, I'm going to smack him in the teeth. These guys are getting up my ass. I can't take it. And he said, and Geezer said to me, he says, you know what? He says, I want to pull out as well. So me and Geezer left together. Tony Iommi used to go to school with the same school as me, although he was in a year higher than me. I remember him at some time, he used to bring his guitar to school and play music, and the kid teachers would get pissed off with him and whatnot, you know. But I never really socialised with Tony at school. He was in a different year than me, you know.
First guitar was one of those, well, a cheap one. Being left-handed was really difficult as well for me to get a guitar. So I think I bought one from one of those K clubs or something, the original guitar. And I really enjoyed playing it. So then I wanted, of course, to be a guitar player.
Tony and Bill had had a band called Mythology up north in a place called Carlisle, which is on the Scottish border. And their bass player and their singer had just left. I was with Geezer, and they went into the music shop, saw the advert, of what I'd called myself Ozzy Zig, I thought the word Zig was like would capture somebody's eye, you know. And then Tony and Bill came round in this van. And originally, we had me singing, Tony playing guitar, Bill playing drums, Geezer playing bass. We had a guy called Jimmy Phillips playing bottleneck guitar, and a guy called Clark, I think, playing sax. We were a six-piece.
Couldn't afford a bass at the time, so I took two strings off my guitar, I used to play bass on the just this bloody little horrible electric guitar I had.
Really?
Well, in fact, that's when we got together as like the Sabbath lineup. I was still using my guitar strung down.
Unbelievable.
I just couldn't afford anything. And then I borrowed a friend, the bass player that was in the band, his bass, to do the first few Sabbath, we were called Earth then,
right,
to do those gigs.
Right.
And it was the first time I'd ever played a bass.
Wow.
Yeah, I had an accident many years ago. As you can see here, where we want it there, that one, that finger and that finger, where I used to do sheet metal work. What happened one day, the day I was leaving, funny enough, from the job to turn professional, the old turn professional one, and I was doing some, pressing this piece of metal that I used to have to weld afterwards, and the press just came straight down on me, and of course, as you pull it back, I pulled the ends of the fingers off. And at the time, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe what I'd done. So I thought that was it. I'll never play again. And what happened was a friend of mine brought me a record. It was the first time I was introduced to Django Reinhardt, who had also got, you know, damaged two fingers and played with two fingers. And it got me back into playing, and I suppose it was 6 or 7 months later. And I started trying to play with these two fingers, like that. So these were bandaged up, and I was playing with these two, which got me to use the little finger as opposed to that finger. And then, of course, I went to try and find some kind of, to the hospital, try and find some kind of tip made so that I could put on, because, of course, if I play here, the string would just rip the skin off because the bone's right underneath. And they said, oh, there's nothing can be done, you'll have to pack up playing and whatever. So I went back home and I got a squeezy bottle and melted it down, made it into a ball, got a hot soldering iron and made a sort of hole in it, and got it down to fit my finger. So I've got this big ball on the end of my finger. Then I sat there all night, filing it down with some sandpaper to make a shape of a thimble. Then I put some leather on it, because it wouldn't grip otherwise, it was plastic, it'd just slip off the string. But put some leather on, which made something like this. This is the plastic and then leather on it. And I used that and off I went. I mean, it's really weird to play with, of course, at first, but you get used to it. And there's certain things I probably wouldn't be able to do that most people could do. But there's other things, I've come up with a different sort of style of playing and probably more unorthodox way, but I've got away with it.
Originally, we went out, we just to think of any name, you know, for the night, you know. But then the saxophone player and the bottleneck guitar player went, and then we went out as Earth. And then we started writing. And Tony was the guy who said, why don't we start writing scary music? And I said, oh, whatever, you know. So we We wrote the song Black Sabbath, we wrote N.I.B, we wrote The Wizard, we wrote Beyond the Wall of Sleep, and all that first album.
How long did it take to do the first Sabbath record? That's pretty quick, wasn't it?
2 days, the first Sabbath, but we'd had 18 months in which to write and play together.
The whole thing with Sabbath, it's the sum of the parts. Ozzy's particular way of singing, Geezer's bass lines, and also the level of the bass in the mix. The bass is a very important part of the Sabbath sound, and it makes it really thick and heavy. I mean, a lot of the time the bass will follow the guitar riff because that's what makes it so heavy and gives it its power. But then there'll be other times when he will be almost saying, well, I'm just as important as the lead guitarist. I'm going to go up the neck and play some fast riffs up here. And that's the kind of thing that appeals to me. In the late 60s, Jack Bruce and his playing with Cream, I know influenced Geezer and also myself.
Oh, yeah, Cream.
Cream.
Hendrix. Oh, no, you know, when Zeppelin came out, they were great first album.
And were there bass players that you listened to or you've listened to?
Well, without a doubt, Jack Bruce.
Really?
He was just like my idol.
He was the guy?
Cream, yeah. I never even thought about a bass guitar until I went to see Cream.
Seriously?
Yeah. He just like completely turned me on to what bass should do. You know, had a totally different style to everybody else, and bending all the notes and everything like that.
Yeah.
I just thought it was incredible, and that's what got me into playing bass. And I still love McCartney, but for different reasons. And then I saw Jack Bruce, and something just went boing in my mind, and it's like, that's what I want to do.
I took the album home and my folks have got one of these old great big radiograms. I says, Mum, I made a record. I was just so happy that I'd made a record, you know. So I hadn't heard all the bells and all this stuff that had been added on. So I put the record on, and it starts with this thunder and the bells and the rain. I'm thinking I've given me the wrong record, you know. And then the music starts. And my folks are ready to do a knees up boo beers drinking song, you know. And my father turned around to me and said, Son, I'm going to ask you a question, and you've got to be honest to me. I said, yeah. He said, are you sure you're just drinking alcohol? I said, yeah. Why, what's the matter? He said, this is very odd music. This is not music. This is weird.
Tried to put music over in a different angle. And the music sounded, you know, it's sort of like this evilly sound, you know, this heavy, doomy sound.
Black Sabbath again was done by just me playing coming up with a riff and playing it sort of loud.
Thank you.
Black Sabbath as a song is a very unique kind of structure. The vast majority of it is almost like three notes. You also hear in Planet Suite, in Mars, down, down, down. It's very similar to down, down, down. To use it in a rock song is very unusual. Black Sabbath is kind of, this is what we are. And musically, you could say it's a simple song, but when you actually come to play it, there's lots of subtle things, timing-wise, where it shifts, gets faster and slower. I know that Tony Iommi has been quite unhappy with the way certain people in later versions of the band have played that song, because really there was a particular way that Bill Ward and Geezer Butler played Black Sabbath, which is kind of essential to try and replicate. It's not rigidly played like a metronome drum machine type thing. It's much more organic. And this, that goes for a lot of Black Sabbath stuff.
Then it goes in towards the end to a, we thought it needed to change by that time, but an up-tempo thing.
We recorded our first album in 12 hours on the way to the ferry to go to do a residency at the Star Club in Hamburg. And so we got the van, pulled up to a place called Regent Sounds, where and I was kind of freaked out, because I know that Paul McCartney recorded Fixing a Hole on the Sgt. Pepper album in his very studio. And I was like, where did he stand? Where did he take a piss? And we did the it was a really crappy studio, like 2 4-track machines. We got, and we all thought that's what everybody does to make a record. And I was saying, well, how do the Beatles sound so great if all you got to do is set your gear up, play, and get in the van? It's, and yet their albums sound so wonderful, you know. I didn't realise that all this stuff's added to it.
So, I mean, in Sabbath, most of the lyrics were yours? Or all the lyrics
were yours?
The original,
yeah. Not well, about 95%.
Really? So Ozzy really had not much to do with the actual songwriting?
He came up with the vocal lines, the melody lines, and he'd come up with, like for instance, Iron Man. He came up with the line Iron Man, so I wrote the lyrics around that subject.
I see.
He used to be good at coming up with like just one line to give you the inspiration to write the rest of the song.
Did you ever use Les Pauls on record?
I used to watch Les Paul on Paranoid, as a matter of fact.
Really?
I did Paranoid, watch Les Paul, the old one.
Paranoid, again, wasn't really going to be as a single. We wasn't intending on doing a single. We were in the studio to write an album, the Paranoid album, which was going to be originally called War Pigs, but that's why the cover was with a chap with a sword and a shield. but they banned it from being called Walking, so we called it Paranoid, which had nothing to do with the cover at all. But anyway, we went in to record the album, and in the lunch break, I didn't go out to eat with the others, I just stayed at the studio and just came up with this riff, this Paranoid. And when everybody came back, I said, well, let's just put this down. So we put it down, and that was it. It wasn't intended as a single or anything, it was just another one for the album. But it did come as a single. Favorite guitars for me is this one. This is the one I always use on stage now. As you can see, it's nice and tidy and clean. No marks at all on it. And this is one I've used for many, many, many years. The original one I had, which I've still got at home, which I don't bring out much now, is a Gibson SG Red, cherry red one. And this one here, again, is another, is the first one I had made by John Burt. This is one of the earlier, first ones he ever made. It's that one. And I got involved with John Burt many years ago when I tried to find somebody to make me, because of the problem with my fingers and stuff, I had to try and create something that I could work with. So I wanted a guitar which was easy strings, I could bend the strings easy, which again I went into using banjo strings for first and made my own sets up because I couldn't buy light gauge strings in them days. And I went to approach different companies to make me light gauge strings. They said, it can't be done, it's impossible. It wouldn't be harmonically right. So I said, it can be done, I've done it. I've dropped all the strings down and made sets up from banjo strings and whatnot. And it worked for me, and I could bend them, and it was good. I got fed up of hearing all this rubbish, so I went to John Birch and asked him if he'd... And we got involved together, and I put the money up for him to start the company, to start making guitars of 24 frets, and this was the first one here. And then we started experimenting with pickups and making pickups and different designs. Which was the ones that's on there now, was some of the first pickups we'd done. But I'd try them on the guitar, on my old Gibson first, and try them on gigs till I found the one that sounded right, and then I'd say, this is the one, and he'd make a couple the same, and then that would be it. And then JD, John Diggins, who used to work for John Birch, now is in charge of his own company, who did come on the road with me and do my guitars. He now got his own guitar company, and he now does my stuff, and he made these pickups for me here, which I really like. And again, I can work with him like I did with John Birch. A lot of the big guitar companies don't seem to, or didn't seem to want to know then, although they may want to know now, but I think they threw a lot away by not listening. Hence the 24 frets and even locking nuts and stuff we were getting into many years ago before these companies would, give it a thought.
Next minute, I know I'm in a club one night, and the manager Jim Simpson comes up to me, and then he goes, "Your album's just gone in the British chart at number 14." I says, "Yeah, pull the other one, you know." And he says, "No," and he stayed in the British charts in the top 10 for 2 years. Then Paranoid came out, and that was like not a bit. And every English band's dream was to come to the US, you know, we came to America, and I mean, we were instantly a success. And I'm looking back, it was like one incredible adventure. My life has been one incredible adventure, from being one level in life going back, to then all of a sudden becoming, having a car, having a flying first class, doing all this exciting stuff. And I mean, it was just like a dream come true. Well, it was a dream come true, you know.
Generals gathered in their masses, just like witches at black masses. Evil minds that plot destruction, sorcerer of death's construction. In the fields the bodies burning, as the war machine keeps turning. Hatred to mankind, poisoning their brainwashed minds. Oh Lord, yeah.
Black Sabbath and Paranoid were quite quickly recorded. Black Sabbath was done in 2 days, and Paranoid was five days to a week. It took us to do that, finish it. But Massive Variety was quite a different thing. That took a lot longer. That's when we started getting to long time for us. It was going into weeks, and oh my God, this is taking a bit long. We tried. There was one particular track that Bill couldn't get right. I think it was Under the Sun or something it was called. And we went to about three or four different studios because it wasn't. Couldn't get the vibe in them days. I don't know how we got to that, but...
Because everybody has their own idea of what a mix should be or what a sound should be. When you get like four people supposedly producing an album, it's always, you know, you have to take so long.
You know, the early part of the success is so much fun, because the first two Sabbath albums were great fun because it was all new. It was all new, and we all had such a laugh, man. No, and then all of a sudden it becomes deadly serious, and people start telling you what you should and shouldn't be doing, and what. And it's always the big. I mean, and if anyone is listening to this, you know, if you're new, you crack the egg, man. You enjoy those first few years of them, because you know you never recapture them again. You know, I've been very lucky, man.
St. John.
Fun with him, it means just like you just go on and you have fun every night. He's just mental as ever on the stage. With Ozzy, it's like everybody just goes and has a great time.
I don't really know. All I go just from stage, I go out and I like to feel that people, I like to try and put over it. I'm trying to put over an honest gig, you know, and making people, I like people to get loose. I like to see people enjoy themselves. I don't like to see people get hurt. I like people, to, it turns me on, you know, and the more they go, the more I feel. And it builds and builds, you know, it just carries on, you know, going and going.
worst festival that I've ever been to, really. It's, everything seems to be so beautiful and peaceful. There's no hassles, you know, the organisation is absolutely incredible, you know. It's just beautiful. It's the way they all should be. We're just going to go on and play our music, man. We don't go on and blow the stage up or do anything like that. We just go on and play our music, man.
Like from being on the stage?
Oh, it was just like an ocean of people, you know, and when all the people's arms were in the air, I'm just lost for words, but I really am. I'm just knocked out with it all. I think if every rock show open air thing could go half as good as this, it could. This is what it's all about, this is.
Just a guitar player that wants to play, and whatever would be something that people would say, well, is unique to me, it would probably be the sound and maybe just the way I approach it, but how it is, I don't know. To explain yourself is quite difficult. I do vibrato on chords, which people never use. Maybe they do now, but I do a sort of play a chord with, and I'll put vibrato on it, which would make it, you know, more full. And the reason for making it full was being as a three-piece band and I just wanted to make it as heavy as I could, so I'd play. So I'd do those sort of things, which would sort of fill it out a bit more by putting the vibrato on. I think at the time they were good for the time. I mean, listening to them now, obviously, it's sort of cringe because of the sound and the whole recording world has changed and the way things can be done now. And I think any past product you listen to, you always go, oh dear, we could have done this and we could have done that. But for the time, no, I think it was all right. And Volume 4, the same. That was good for us at the time we'd done Volume 4, because it was the first time I think we'd actually recorded in America. And we went over to LA and it was great. It was great times. It was a whole new thing to be recording in sort of record plant. And we thoroughly enjoyed it. It was good.
What happened with me and Black Sabbath was it became, at the beginning we all had a purpose, but as it went along, that inevitable thing stepped in called ego. To get four guys to come up with the same result at the end of the day was near on impossible, because not saying I was better than them, not saying they were better than me, but the fact is, that success does change you. I mean, when you're hungry, you all have one goal to have, and that is to get successful. Now, when you get successful, it affects various people. I mean, it affected me. I didn't give a shit. I was full of cocaine and all the rest of the crap that I used to do, you know? So, I mean, that stuff makes you talk total horse crap, you know. The amount of, there shouldn't be a problem in the world, because I think we solved them all in a bathroom of a hotel with a bag of that white powder, you know.
I just don't know, I just haven't got a clue. Well, we just got stoned all the time, and you know, couldn't get any, stoned sort of like out of it like all the time. We couldn't think, because we'd got Volume 4 together out in LA, and we thought that, but being away from home made us work more. And get into it more. But it was just like a party from time to time. It was like a holiday, man. We all went out there and just got crazy all the time.
I got the rap of being stoned and drunk all the time. You know, I wasn't the only one, man. I mean, we were all in a bad way, man.
Has your sound gotten better? I mean, do you think you've learned how to...
No. It's always hit and miss with me. I think I've got it a lot better than I used to have it now, mm-hmm. Yeah? Seems easier for me to... Because before, I just didn't have a clue how to get the bass out of what the road you're doing. And just go on and play. And I think with me, it's like everybody says that... No matter what I'm using, my bass or equipment, I always get that sound anyway. Mm-hmm. It's just the same as Tony always gets his
right,
sound.
And exactly.
You find that with a lot of people. There's
yeah.
Whatever the sound is, no matter what guitar or amp they're using, they get that sound.
Exactly. Exactly.
Well, Sabbath is again, I thought that was the best album to date then. It was a lot more involved. And we'd done stuff, we went a bit more adventurous by using sort of perhaps more acoustic sort of things and a bit more musical, I thought, than the other albums up to that date. Again, we went over to LA. We'd done the same procedure we did with Volume 4, but it didn't work on Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath. We went over, rented a house for 6 months and went over there, and same house and everything. It just didn't work. We couldn't get the same atmosphere, and we couldn't write. So we ended up coming back to England and went to Clerwell Castle in Wales and wrote Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath.
Has there been huge changes in terms of working in studios and technology and the types of sounds you can get? And, you know, I think you've always been pretty much of a purist. I don't know how much you've been affected by that, really.
Yeah, I think I tend to venture out into some various other things, but I find now it's gone really back to the basic. Or, I think, because we started looking at points of looking for more. These flashy studios and whatever else, and we totally went the wrong way. And we found out the best thing was in like the real down to earth studio. We've got the sound, it didn't matter how it looked, as long as we got the sound. Mm-hmm. But we did go through a period where, oh, this looks nice, we'll work it out.
I do and I don't because, like, I never go out and think about the bread room acting. All I want to go out and see is the kids there and enjoying what I'm playing to them. I don't go on stage thinking, fuck, man, I've earned $5, $10 and count them bread as it's going along. I don't want to know, man. It's not, I'm not in it for that. I mean, it's just to purely turn people on, you know. And I'll do it as best way I can, you know. I mean, like, for years I'd bone around for fucking nothing, you know. I got screwed out of a lot of money from time to time. In previous other ventures I'd done before the band, I'd always been ripped off by people in the past. And I think, well, fucking hell, man, if that's where it's at, man, I don't want to know. Man. All I want to do is be able to have a comfortable life, feed my kids, feed my wife, and put a roof over their heads, and make sure my kids have a good upbringing. You know, a good upbringing. Whereas, like, as my parents give me as best one as they could, but like I can just give them that a little bit more, you know.
Right, but it's not.
a time when we brought a keyboard player in instead of Geezer or myself playing keyboards as we did on some of the past stuff, apart from Wakeman played on Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath track. We brought a keyboard player in, we were getting to use involved keyboards a bit more, and we thought, well, we don't want to keep playing and we're not good enough to keep playing these things. So we brought a keyboard player in when we wrote Technical Ecstasy. And I must admit, I quite enjoyed it. I enjoyed that album, although I think I was a bit too self-indulgent for me. I think I got a bit too over the top with it, because I got more into the production side then and I was fiddling about. And, but yeah, I think it was probably a slightly apart from some of the other albums we've done.
I think with the new album that Sabbath is going in a little different direction. I think it's...
No, I think what do you mean, in what way?
I mean, I think
it's going in a better direction.
Yeah.
And it's definitely going into a better direction. You never sort of, when you start to record and write an album, you never sort of sit down and say, well, we'll put it in this way, or we just sort of sit down and sort of, it just happens, it's just born, you know. You never know what it's going to turn out like, it's just something that's born and it's there, you know. I think this last album is one of the best one we've ever done, you know. If this is anything to go by, I can't wait to do it.
Right.
The next album, or the next but one, you know.
Right.
Because, like, you know, it's just incredible. I can't believe it. This last album, man.
It's almost like
it's
not
a
rebirth. Yeah, like it's almost not distinguishable as a Black Sabbath album, but yet it is.
Technical Ecstasy may have been the title from them, I would think, and I think Storm interpreted that as two robots falling in love, which I then set out to draw, and I drew them as just sketches. And then later on, we looked at it, and it wasn't a very interesting story because they were just falling in love, and we had them fall in love on an escalator, one going up, one coming down, just because it made it a sadder tale, basically. There's a wonderful story of someone shouting up the stairs when Black Sabbath, I wasn't there, but when Black Sabbath went to Hypnosis in Denmark Street, someone shouting up the stairs, Poe, Deep Sabbath are here to see you.
I think a lot of people... I think it shocked a lot of people. It shocked me. You fucking shocked the shit out of me, man.
I mean, was there something that, I mean, that just, that caused it? I mean, was it circumstances, or just was at the time?
I just don't know. I just haven't got a clue.
At the time of recording the Evan and Al, which wasn't called Evan and Al at that time, before that. And it just wasn't working, things just wasn't happening. We were ended up recording for 11, well, rehearsing for 11 months and nothing was coming up. So we'd come up with plenty of riffs and stuff, but no, there was no enthusiasm. So it just had to come to an end, and we had to have a talk, so it's not going to happen.
But there wasn't a row. It was what happened was... I was getting musically frustrated because we were working on the road to pay lawyers' fees to keep the lawsuit going against the manager who was ripping us off. And I just said, hey man, well, I didn't get involved in this to become a damn lawyer. I don't know the first, I don't understand the business side of it. I don't want to, I don't. No, he said, now it seems my music's paying off my tax demands. That's the line. And we'd never paid tax, so we had to pay tax and all this and whatever.
It was the time when Ozzy went then. I think at that time he was going through a lot of problems himself, and we needed to sort of get away from each other, and we needed to do our own thing, I think. Or he certainly needed to do his own thing, which he did, and quite successful with it.
I said to the band one day, I said, you know, I want to do a solo album. And they said, well, Tony said to me, well, we're a band. I said, yeah, but I'd like to do something on my own, you know. And you know, it's all for one and one for all, as you know, the scene, you know. But I was still wanted to do something aside from Sabbath. Not saying that I was any better than Sabbath, because Sabbath, in my opinion, from 1968 till after I left with the two Dio albums involved, was one of the greatest bands I ever worked with. But I just had this thing that I had to vent my thing and do something what I wanted to do, you know? So I said to Tony, and he says, well, if you've got any ideas, you should put them to the band, because we're a band, you know? It'd be great if I come up with something and didn't give it to you guys. And then I said, oh, fair enough, then okay. What do you think about this? Don't like it. What do you think about this? Don't like it. What do you think about this? Don't like it. What do you think about this? And so on. I didn't like anything. So here am I. I'm still frustrated. I don't like what I've done. They said, tell me that if I've got any ideas, you should give to the band. I've given them to the band. They don't like it. So I'm still in the same hole. But now I'm more frustrated because I've got this desire to do a solo album. And so I left. I just thought, this is crap, you know. So, that wasn't the reason why I left. Was because that we would write a song, book a studio, and try and finish the album in a studio, which is just total crap to me. I don't like being in a studio.
Really, any bad blood between you and Ozzy at the end there?
It's off and on between me and him. You know, we have massive fights and never don't speak to each other for 2 years. And it's like, you know, I've probably said at least 3 times I'll never ever play with Ozzy again in my life. And then time goes by and we start talking again and get together again.
Yeah.
Just one of those sorts of relationships. Mm-hmm. Weird.
Mm-hmm.
Is that special? I mean,
it was,
being out there and...
It was good.
Welcome to number four, new LP notes, and I may take loud, man. If you want to clap, you can.
I think every time you look back, you'll see. At the time, they say, oh, God. Yeah. When you look back, years from now, oh, that was great. Yeah. Even though Buddy sees it, you know that was a good time. Because you always remember them good times. And...
like a fun gig is that everybody just has a great time.
You know, in the 60s there were only a few bands that were doing that, to my mind.
Yeah.
You know, and just to see it kind of progress, you know, being a part of it.
It just feels great to be on the ground floor with it. It really does. It feels good. It's just, you know, so the people of, when I've read articles and write-ups of bands that we were, you know, their idols at that time or whatever, you know, it's good, isn't it?
Yeah.
When I get all these grandfather gifts sent and stuff like that, you know.
Sense the influence Sabbath has had on these bands? I mean, can you hear it? And...
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, I mean the whole style of music, the lyrical content, just the heaviness of it, and the riffs, and the way the bass and guitar play together, everything. Mm-hmm. But I like the bands that have taken the essence of it, you know, doing their own thing.
Mm-hmm.
Hughes and Butler, great musicians. Certainly, I found, after, particularly now, after playing with a lot of different musicians, that Hughes and Butler are quite unique in their style of playing. Their old style of what they played made Black Sabbath what it was.
I meet people, I met a guy the other day in at an in-store. He showed me a ticket from 1971. That's when he discovered me and my music with the Black Sabbath. And so he's locked onto that era. And he may not like any of the other stuff, but he locked on for me for that period.